17 minutes after 7, so how does the Auckland market compare to the rest of the country? Joining me now is QV National Spokesperson, David Nagel. David, good to have you on the program. What do the regions look like compared to Auckland? It seems that maybe the regions are following a bit in Auckland's footsteps now.
Yeah, they're following well behind the footsteps of Auckland, Duncan, but I think even the juice is coming out of the provinces now too. The 15 major cities that we track in terms of the value growth are all showing some signs of decline declines in growth as you move through, and we've seen that over the last 2 or 3 months now.
Some of these regions, though, I mean, they were starting to pick up on this as well. When they picked up, they really picked up, and I think some of the good signs for the regions are that if you look at some of the house price increases over the last year, it is the smaller towns and cities that are actually winning this battle now. It's not Auckland, it's not Queenstown, it's actually, you know, it's the Whangarei's, it's the Rotoruas, it's the places like this, Napier, Hastings.
Yeah, you're spot on, Duncan, and when we look at Auckland, we had 4 or 5 years very, very strong growth, leading right through to late last year. For the provincial cities, we've seen that growth really only kick on in the last 12 to 18 months, but at a much more rapid pace. And of course, in the last few months, what we've seen is the smaller provinces, it's their time to shine, if you like. And those areas have really been flatlining since the GFC. So we're talking nearly 10 years of absolutely no value growth. And all of a sudden, the market sprung to life in these smaller towns like Kawerau, you know, 28% year-on-year growth for the last 12 months, and little towns like Greytown and Martinborough and Featherston, all of a sudden 25 to 28% growth in 12 months.
They were coming off nothing, though, weren't they? I mean, places like Kawerau, you know, you get a house for $80,000 there. Now it's $200,000.
Yeah, and that's the thing. It's very affordable housing, and which you don't get in the major centres.
Mm. Hey, just tell me, people have basically got this chicken going on, haven't they? Because they're not actually sure what to do, so they don't do anything, and that creates a bit of a crisis of confidence, doesn't it?
Yeah, I'm not sure about a crisis, but certainly the property market hates uncertainty. And while we're in a bit of limbo at the moment, even though we probably have a pretty fair idea of what is going to influence the property market with a new government. There's still that lingering doubt there, and so it's going to be very interesting to see what happens over the next month or two.
It is. Hey, what's QV picking? I mean, I know you don't do predictions, I suppose. You know, you look at what the stats are, but I mean, do we think that these prices in the regions are going to continue to go up as they are?
Well, Duncan, the bones of the market are still very strong. We've got very low interest rates still. We've still got good migration data coming through, although that's likely to fall off over the coming years. So everything's positive, a strong economy that's going to continue to be that way. So a lot will depend on what happens, I think, with the LVR restrictions and what a new government will do to try and influence the Reserve Bank to maybe reduce those restrictions. Because if they are reduced, well, there'll be a lot more first home buyers that can enter the market, a lot more investors too that will be able to buy their second or third or fourth home. So that will have a big impact on the future property market.
Oh, I totally agree. The first home buyers shut out in the last couple of years. They need to be the priority, I think, anyway, in the next term. Hey, good on you, David. Appreciate your time on the program. Really appreciate you getting up for us. We are 21 minutes after 7 o'clock.